Hi, my name is Matt Espindola, and I'm a consultant here at MRC, the company behind Empower, the web development platform. Now, if you haven't used Empower before, Empower is a development platform that allows anyone to build web applications in a matter of minutes rather than days or possibly weeks, all from a point-and-click interface. This video, the point is to show you how you can build a shopping cart from the ground up, so starting with nothing, and having a complete series of apps that demonstrate a shopping cart and the functionality behind that. Now, I will say that this video is not made to be a training video, but it's made to demonstrate just what Empower is capable of, how the application building process looks like, and of course, what are some of those built-in components and features that allow you to easily make these functional and rich applications. So if you're a new user or somebody who's just experiencing and wanting to check out what Empower can do, this is great for you. It's also very beneficial if you're an existing Empower user to just see some of these features and built-in components that maybe you're familiar with but just don't have the greatest exposure to using. So you can certainly benefit from that as well. Now, I'll certainly highlight some of the Empower components here that will be covered in this video, and this is just some of the many that are built right in, meaning that you don't have to reinvent the wheel. All of that is accessible to you while you're building your applications. So before I begin building any applications, I'd like to first talk about the process of how the shopping cart applications are going to work, and then sure enough show you a pre-built demo that I've made ahead of time to show you exactly what all of that looks like. This whole shopping cart process, in a nutshell, this is the overview of how this is going to look and how our applications are going to function. The first thing we'll have is two main applications, a product catalog and a checkout screen, and these are the screens the user is always going to see and interact with. The catalog just has all the items that are available to shop from, and then the checkout screen is where the user can finalize their purchase, update or remove quantities from their carts, and then of course complete the checkout process, which behind the scenes will submit the order and then also email that customer their receipt. So in either the product catalog or checkout screen, the user will be able to add or remove items from their cart dynamically. All this is going to use is actually two database tables, a products table and a cart table. And the whole process here, all these screens and how this all is going to work, is that we're going to use security. So we'll know who the user is when they sign into the applications, and this security and knowing who the user is going to help make sure that the user is always looking at items that they've added to their cart and that we can always get the email to go to that specific user. Now, continue with the shopping cart demo, which I'm going to be showing you. I'd like to first give you an idea of how the finished product is going to look, what you can expect that we're going to work towards, how this shopping cart is actually going to function. And so you have that clear picture of what we're actually heading towards here. So when I sign into my application, this is my first main app that I've built. This is like a product catalog where you can see that each of these little cards has some details about my products, the price, the description, some of those other fields there. And this button, remove to cart, add to cart, will add the item or remove it respectively from my current shopping cart. I can see up here in the right upper right corner, I have a total of my cart. As I keep adding or removing items, that total updates. And just like any catalog, you want to have filters that the user can use on this page. So right now this is all just bicycles and accessories like helmets, clothing. So you can see some of these filters that I got from clicking on the selections button. I can search on like a product's description. Maybe I only want to see mountain bikes, I can search on that. Or maybe I know that I only want to see items that are under $100. So these filters are built in. We'll also be using these in the app that we make. If I click on the total of my cart, this will take me to another main application that I built ahead of time. And this is like a final review screen where the user can look at the items they've added to the cart. If they want to update some of these quantities or maybe get rid of an item, they can do that all from this screen. And once the user has finalized and reviewed any items that are in the cart, I get a confirmation that that was indeed submitted. And I've also gotten an email that got sent to me with a little bit of text and then a link that will generate a PDF, a receipt of the order that I just made. Now, some of the features or components that we're going to discuss and add to this application is the idea of security. You'll notice I logged into the application at the very beginning, so that way we can have each user identified who's shopping through the catalog. Something else we'll discuss is this idea of responsive design, where if I shrink down this window that my application is currently in, I can emulate what this same application would look like to a user on a smartphone, for example. And this is the responsive design piece at play. These Bootstrap applications have this logic built into them where you can customize and make sure that your content is appropriately resizing at all different possible screen sizes, so that way the same application looks good at any resolution that a user is viewing it on. Now, besides the responsive design piece, I also made mention of the filtering that's included in this application. And then there's going to be some other components that you don't see directly on the screen, other applications or auxiliary helper apps, as I like to call them, that are going to serve a purpose or a role for us, such as sending out that email or doing some other actions that make this whole process very seamless and just flows naturally. All right, so that's the goal, the idea that we're working towards. So let's go ahead and kick things off by logging into the Empower Development interface. Now, once we're signed in, the very first thing that we're going to want to do is to create a new dictionary or environment for us to work in, where this is going to have all our applications, have all our different fields, everything pertaining to our shopping cart is going to be inside this dictionary that I'll call ShopCart. So once I've created my new dictionary, I can click on the current one that I'm in and search for ShopCart, the dictionary. And once I'm inside of here, there's going to be no applications, no tables, because as I mentioned, we're going at this from a ground-up approach. We have nothing and we're going to finish with everything. So in this dictionary, before I can actually build any apps, I'll go to this Manage Tables screen, and in here, clicking this Register Table button, I'm going to just bring in some tables from my database that I can work with and build the apps over. So inside of this ShopCart schema, I've already created some tables ahead of time that I'm just going to pull in. So I just brought in my Products table. And before I leave this screen, I'm going to go in the Fields section here, edit all my fields. And what I really just want to do is update any of the descriptions on my fields, change any of the formats of how some numbers are displayed, maybe I'll put the list price in terms of dollars and cents. And it's just good to do this. It's good practice to register the table and then update any of your descriptions from here, because then every time you build an application over this table, it's going to have those updated descriptions already in place for you. So the first app I'm going to build is going to be a retrieval. Now, retrievals as a whole are an application type that allow the user to retrieve or look up data from their database. For my purposes, I need to be able to see all the products in my products table, and the multiple row data list template will do just that. You'll see that I named this application Product Catalog because that's the first building block or first piece that we're creating. And just to show you that screenshot of that screen from the demo, take my products table and all the fields within that table, sequence my application by the product ID, let's go ahead and just build this application as is. Now, once you reach that build and customize tab, Empower's, this is the bread and butter, where Empower generates the Java file, the HTML file, the XML file. It's making all that hundreds of lines of code for you. Now, once this is finished, the only thing to do is press the execute application, and there you have it. Now we've just built the product catalog retrieval. Now you'll immediately notice that this product catalog I just built looks nothing like the one that I showed you in the demo. And that's because we haven't customized this app yet. We've built the foundation of the application, and now once we have that in place, then we can focus on really customizing and changing the look and feel of this application. The first thing I'll address is this selections button. In my demo, I had these filters. They didn't show up as a pop-up window. They instead slid out directly above the screen. And I think that's just cleaner, it's easier to use, and it just looks a little nicer. So I'm going to make that change in my application. Go to the application settings, pick my display filters above table. And once I save that change, in order to see it take place, I'm going to rebuild the application, and I will overwrite the HTML. Rerunning the app, and sure enough, now the selections with those filters behaves differently. So nothing we had to do except just make one quick change and then rebuild the application. Now if you look at the actual data, you see the application is outputting 10 products or 10 records on a single screen, and the other items can be found using the paging tool. For my application, I always want all the items to show up right away. So in the properties, I can change the max rows to display. I'll say this is 30, that's more than the total items I have. And I'll also change this automatically save row count to no. Just save that property change, run the app again, and now it's going to listen to my default value and always show me all the items on the screen. So now that I'm certain the core meat and bones of my application looks good, I've got the fields that I want, I'm going to go back to this Build and Customize tab, click on Edit Presentation, and once you click on this, it's going to open up MPainter, our HTML editor, our GUI tool that allows you to work with your presentation layer. And the first thing I'm going to do is remove this table entirely, and instead, right where that table is removed, I'm going to replace this insert element. I'm going to replace that table with a card instead. Now this card is built into the Bootstrap library that these Empower applications utilize. And you'll see once I add in that card, it puts in the HTML, the whole structure of that card for me. If I save my application and then refresh this page, it's going to look completely different because now I'm going to be using those cards to put in for each of my items. So I've got this card in my application. Back in MPainter, I'm going to remove some of the placeholder text and replace it with the fields, clicking that fields button, that are in my application. So in the header, I'll put that product ID, and then maybe the class of the product as well. So you can replace these at your own discretion. Take out that long text and put in my long description. So go ahead and save that, refresh the application, and now I can see the card is pulled in the last item of the data set, but the content looks good, it's in the right spots. What I might do here though is format the text inside of the card so that way it's actually centered. Someone goes to view the item. Just like that. Now back inside my cart, I'm also going to insert an image that's tied to every single product. Before I do that, I'm going to select this product ID that I've put in the card, go to this user interface, edit element tool, and I just want to copy the bit of HTML that is being used for the product ID. And now that I've got that copied, I'll go ahead and insert my image. And in this URL box, I'm going to put where my images on the Empower server all live, and they're inside of this folder structure. And that little bit of HTML I copied, this is just going to substitute for every single product the appropriate product number tied to that product. So once I press OK, I'll also center the image in the card. Before I rerun this to see how my images look, just want to do some additional formatting to my fields, make the product ID stand out in the header just by bolding and underlining that. Then maybe the same thing for some of these other fields. And for this particular item, there's the correct image associated to the product. Now, something you've noticed immediately when I removed the table in favor of putting in these cards to show our items, that I lost all the multiple items that are showing. Well, we can add that logic back into the application that will print out every single product. But before we do that, we want to use this layout tool in the toggle grid mode so we can create some space in the HTML for the other products that are going to be printed out, or the other cards. So you want to make sure you're clicked inside of this box where the card is. You'll see that red outline. You can go to Grid Row Options, Configure Row Layout. Select this layout here just to give me some more space to work with in the row. And I'll drag the current card contents into that first box. Once I press OK, now the card is only taking up a fourth of this entire row, which you'll see right here. Now that my card spacing looks a lot better, I can come back to MPainter and put in that looping logic to print all the cards. So if you click inside the card, you can go to the user interface, edit element option, and this is going to bring up the element that you inspected in the HTML source. Now, most of the time you can just use the MPainter GUI to make your HTML changes. However, there's some scenarios where there's more advanced editing that you'd like to do. This edit element tool is great because it just brings up a little bit of the source, whatever element you're inspecting, without you ever having to fully diverge into the full HTML source. So I've selected that Move to Parent button, and I want to make sure that I can see this card and right above that this class Col3. And to insert that looping logic, click on the Empower Free Marker drop down here and select List Retrieval Data. And this just sticks two lines of code into my application. I'll press OK. Then I'm going to come right back into the window here, go to the User Interface Edit Element tool again. And this time I still am going to move to Parent to go back to where I was and go up one more level, because I want to take out these extra spaces, all those replace this, all those extra divs or those spaces. I don't need those. I can get rid of them. So I'll take those out, press OK. Now I'll save, and when I rerun the application, now I can see all the cards have printed out for me, all the cards in the data set. So you can see that with about 10 minutes of working inside of Empower, of building the application, then using MPainter to edit and customize this HTML, we've pretty transformed how this application looks from that default table view to this whole card structure, and not a whole lot of time. So let's touch up some minor details in this application. First thing is the selections button that brings open or slides down those filters. Right now this takes up too much real estate on the screen, so we're going to clean up that window. So back in MPainter, let's open that file. And once I'm in the selections page here, I can go to the layout, form layout mode, and it brings up this tool that just allows you to easily remove some of the inputs you don't want, and also split up a row. So I can split this one row into some equal pieces and move my input boxes there. I don't want the product ID. I will take the description, the class, and the list price. I can apply that new layout, so now I only have the three filters on the same row. For each filter, you can also go to the text field properties here, and I like to add a little icon where this icon right is, just as a way that it's just a nice visual to have on there. Which looks like just like that. So I'll do the same for the other two inputs here. Also with these filters, you'll see they have their relationship that you're searching on. These you can change, default them to something else. For description, usually a user is going to be searching for a few letters or a certain word, so the contains is probably a better relationship to set as the default. And now that's set there. I can do the same for the list price. Say that a user probably wants to search on items that are less than or equal to like a certain value or certain price. For the class filter, I'm going to put a drop-down list on here, so that way someone doesn't have to type what they want to search for. And now there's just those three filters with the little icons, and this class has a drop-down list. Well, looking at this drop-down list, something I don't like is that the numbers are showing. I'd rather put the class description on there. So to do that, I'm going to come back in here, edit my drop-down list, and I'm going to make my own custom list. This use a custom list option and create my quick list, and this will allow me to do exactly that. Make a list that has the numbers that the data set uses, but also have the descriptions show up in the list. So value 100 corresponds to the bicycles class. Value 200 is for my accessories. And then class 300 is for the clothing products. So now you can see it where it says select a custom quick list. That's the list that I've just made and it's selected. So I'll press OK. Save this again. And now the list has the appropriate or better descriptions on here, but it still submits the correct value behind the scenes. Now that list I made is actually completely reusable. And I can use that same list here. On each card you see that class number is printing. Well, let's show the description there. Find my class field, right click and insert edit key lookup. And this lookup retrieval, I should be able to just pick the quick list that I had originally made. And under field to return, this value, this is going to correspond to the description, the bicycle accessories, the actual text that I want to show. So I'll select that, press OK, and now each card header has the descriptions Now in my demo, I demonstrated the idea of responsive design, which if you shrink down this window, you can emulate like a tablet or a smartphone view of this same application. And if you imagine this was a smartphone view, the application looks pretty butchered. So we're going to fix this in MPainter. So in the layout and then toggle grid mode, I'm going to select the element I want to resize appropriately. So that's the card. So I'll go to the grid row options and responsive column. And so in here, this is where I'm going to tell MPower and tell my application how many cards to essentially fit on each row for all these different screen sizes. So once I save that change and show the same emulation again of shrinking down the window, you'll notice that each breakpoint the content snaps and then resizes the cards to show only two per row or three cards per row. So this way the content is never scrunched up and looks terrible no matter what device someone is on. It's going to resize appropriately. So this product catalog is more or less complete. What I will address is getting this button to actually add or remove items from the cart. And there's going to be another application we'll build behind the scenes, a maintainer, that's going to do that for us. But before I actually get into building another application, I'm going to come into the admin menu and this application menu in security and turn on security for my dictionary, which I can click that enable dictionary security. And the reason I'm doing this is because adding items to the card or deleting them, the whole logic behind that needs to know who is indeed adding the item or removing it. So the turning on this security is going to allow me to track that user. Now to actually add some users to this to my dictionary, I'll go to Manage Runtime Users. And I'm going to create two users. The first is going to be for myself. Some of these fields I'm going to fill out because these values can be used elsewhere, notably the email. I can use this email that I enter here to later on when I send out a receipt of the order, I can just pull in that email right there. So I filled out all the fields for my user. Now when you're creating applications like we are here that depend on the current user, it's never a bad idea to create a second user that you can just use as like a test. That way you can easily switch between the different users and make sure your application works as intended. So feel free to do that really quickly if you'd like. That's what I'm doing here. And now I've got two users. So I've got security turned on. Let's go to our manage data, manage tables. And I'm going to register another table. This time this table is going to be a cart table, which I've created again ahead of time. And this table has just fields to hold items that are added to the cart. So you'll see some of the similar fields like product ID, the product description, and of course the quantity, some of those other fields in here. You'll see there's also a username in here that again is tying back to that idea of tracking who's adding the item to the cart. So with my table registered, now I'm going to actually create that maintainer. Maintainers are a bit unique from all the other application types in MPower simply because they allow the user to maintain or modify the actual data on the database. And the template type that I'll be using for my maintainer is the single row web form. Select my cart table. And I'll take all those fields. Now sequencing, what makes each item added to the cart unique is the user who added it, and then the actual product. So I have two sequence fields here. And in my field settings, I know that this field is always going to track who the user is. So in this audit column, I'm going to just have this value always be whoever's adding or changing, well, adding or deleting a record. So let's go ahead and build this. So now that I turned on the security, remember that before I can run any apps, I have to sign in. So once I do that, I can see the app that I just built, and here it is. So if I manually enter in an item to add to my cart here, just to show you, once I submit that, it adds that item to my cart. And I can look in the actual table, click on this spyglass here, will let me see the actual table. And there's that item, and you'll see that my username, which I'm tracking, also gets added to the record. Now this screen, a user's not going to manually type in all that information here. We're going to call it behind the scenes from the product catalog. Now when it's called, I don't want someone to get stuck on this screen. I want it to go right back to the product catalog. So I'm going to configure that in this After Actions workflow to say that I'll click on my Add Actions and select this action. So once the maintainer is submitted, once the item is added or deleted, I just want to redirect to another page. And this is simply going to go back to the product catalog. So we already built that application. It's retrieval 10. Don't need to map any fields. I can just save this as is. And now the workflow designer will show me exactly what I'm doing after the maintainer is fired off. With this maintainer built, let's turn our attention to linking this back to the first retrieval we built. You can use this quick navigation to get back to my product catalog. So there's that application, and I'm going to open it up in MPainter. And this button, this is where I'm going to configure that link to actually go to or add the item with that maintainer. So just go ahead and find that application. Once you have that there, we need to add the link parameters, which we can just pass along the fields from the catalog to the maintainer. With my example, I'm always also going to pass along a quantity that gets added of just one. And I will have a screen later on where I can change that, but that's what I'll do for now. And lastly, to my link, I need to tell it to add the record and set this one step equal to yes. Now before I save and test my link, probably change the text on here. So I can test the link, see that it actually adds the item and passes along all the details. So I just added 1030, 81030, and there it is right there. So the button and the link I just configured is only always going to add an item to the cart. However, if I click right here and have my cursor next to that button, I can add another button link that's going to serve the purpose of removing the item from the cart. So I can click on my link, and this is going to go right back to that same maintainer that the first link was pointing to. And for the link parameters, I don't need to actually pass every single parameter because I'm not adding or writing the record. I just need to pass along the product ID. And that's it. The username, you'll remember, is being passed, or it's being used behind the scenes already in the maintainer, so that's why I didn't need it in either link directly. And this will be a button. I can change that, and I'll use this danger, this red color theme. Now I should be able to test out that button. So I know that I added 10:10 and 10:30 to the cart, so I can remove 10:10, and now it's gone. Now, even though both of these links work and they perform their intended function, right now the app is a little confusing because if a user adds an item, if I add A1060, I have no visual cue to know if that item's in the cart or not. What would be better is to show the add item if the item is not already in the cart, or to only show this button if the item is not in the cart. So to accomplish this, I'm going to use another application that is going to look up or check for the item if it's already in my cart. This is going to be a new retrieval, and I'll call it check for item in cart. And this is going to use the JSON lookup template. And this template is always going to do exactly that. It's going to look up behind the scenes a value for us, and that looked up or returned value can be used in other applications that we've already built. If you've ever used the VLOOKUP function in Microsoft Excel, this template pretty much mirrors that functionality. And this is going to be over my cart table. And I can just go ahead and take all the fields from here. I'll sequence my app by product ID. Now, once I'm in the additional options, I want to add two calculations. The first is going to be like a flag calculation that if the item exists, then I'm going to print out just this Y, this letter. And then I'm going to create another calculation just to always pull in the current user. And this is going to be under calc type. You can choose system value, and there's a username option there. So just setting that equal to the calculation. And in the record selections, since I am using that calc to get the current user, I want to make sure that the username that is in my cart table, so that field there, is always equal to the calculation that again pulls in the current user. So that way I can be sure the output of this application is always looking at just the items for that particular user. So the output of this application, it's just this raw text. In this case, it just shows me the two items that I have in the cart. And again, I'm going to use this lookup to just check for a flag, and that's how I'm going to know in the catalog whether or not to show the right button. So I'm going to head back to my product catalog and open that up in MPainter so I can tie this lookup retrieval to use in there. So open up my product catalog in MPainter. And where these two buttons are, I'll just click on or near them and pull open the user interface edit element tool. So I want to make sure I can see both links, and here those are. So to insert and call the logic of my JSON lookup retrieval, I can click on the Empower Free Marker drop down here and select JSON lookup for comparison. And once I pick this option, it's going to insert for me all the necessary text that I need to call the lookup. So I'm going to take this string for the lookup here and actually move it right below or right above my very first button link. And then this if else statements, I'm just going to place the else right below the first button, and this ending if that ends my conditional logic below the second button. So you can see the general syntax of this is that it's going to look up my retrieval, the JSON lookup retrieval, find that value, in this case that flag, and say if the flag is this value, then show this button. Otherwise, show the other button. So I just need to substitute where this first line is all my values that correspond to the JSON lookup retrieval. So dictionary, this replaced with shop cart, the app number is retrieval 20. The replace key field name, this is the key or sequence field in the JSON lookup retrieval, which is the product ID. The replace field name to return is what I'm looking up, and that is that calc flag. So I'll put that calcula 1. And I'm looking to compare this against that single value y. So here I'm going to say that if the lookup is not equal to y, then show the add item to cart button. Otherwise, the item is already in the cart, so then just display the other button. And I can press OK here. Save my changes. So now when a user is shopping, there's no confusion on whether or not the item is already in the cart or is not in the cart. So now that we've got the product catalog working and we're able to add items or remove them, we don't really have a final screen to review those items or update any quantities for the items we've added. So that's the next app that I'm going to build. And this is going to be another maintainer. This is like a final review screen, which is going to look very similar to this. And this is going to be a grid update maintainer. This is also going to be over the cart table. And this will be sequenced by the username and the product ID, just like the first maintainer that we built was. Now inside of this grid update maintainer, I want to make a calculation for the total price of an item in the cart, because I know the quantity of items that are going to be in the cart, and then I know the list price of the item, so this calculation will tell us exactly how much the total price is for that item. And lastly, I'm going to go into field settings and add in some validation on my quantity field to make sure that the quantity entered on the item is always greater than 0, so someone can't have like a negative quantity or a value that doesn't make sense. So if you can imagine, the user would come here to finalize any quantities in their cart, update and remove items before they actually check out. Now you'll see here that this is all pointing to that cart table, and that I may have other users, like Billy is another user who's been shopping and adding items to the cart. Well, I don't want to show Billy's items, I only want to show mine. So in the properties in the SQL statement, this secure application by property will allow me to only show or secure the application by my username, since I am using security and tracking the user. So that way, whenever this application is ran, I'm only going to see my items in the cart and I won't see any other user's items. So now I'm going to get into MPainter, do some customization to this app, remove some columns I don't want, make sure a user can't come in here and change the price of the item, and just in general touch up this screen. So let me first remove the username column. I don't need the user to see that. The list price, class, and description, I'm going to make these inputs read-only, so that way a user can't change the value inside of those, but can still see them. So I'll do the same for class and description. Now the description, this is in a text area box. So in the text area properties, I want to shrink this down. Instead of taking up 5 rows by default, just have it take up 1. And that will save some space in my application. And something I've already done in my previous applications is put in product image for each product. So I'll go ahead and just repeat that in this application. Now the quantity field, I didn't make this read-only because a user should be able to update the quantity here. But I can come into the text field properties and set the type to number. And this is just going to give the user the ability to press these arrows on the input to increment or take away from the quantity. So looking at the application thus far, there we have it. There's those images, the inputs that I set to read only. Now a user can't come in here and change those, okay. But they can still update these quantities as need be. Some other cosmetics on this app: get rid of some of these buttons that aren't going to have a use in the application, as well as update some of the text over here. So I'll just get rid of these buttons that I'm not going to need in this application. In this accept button, I'll change the text to just say update cart. And something I like to do is also occasionally just add text to my application so the user it just has clarity on what they're doing. So in the toggle grid mode, I'm going to actually insert a row right above here that's just above the items. Now I will add another button to here as well that is going to take the user back to the catalog, since I want this screen to kind of work hand in hand with the other retrieval I built, putting a simple button in there will help the user just navigate between the two screens. So I've just added some text for my button. I put in a little icon, and I can select all that there and go to link and just make this button link go right back to the catalog. So now if you imagine on this page, once the user finalizes the selections, I want them to click that checkout button that I've yet to add, and then they can send a receipt to themselves. So this receipt is going to be really just a report that gets sent out. So I'm going to create that report right now. I'll just call this order receipt. Just like you saw in the demo, this is going to be ran to a PDF that looks very similar to this. Should be the regular report template. And this is going to be over the cart table. I can just take all the fields from that table. This application is sequenced by the username as well as the product ID. And both of those subtotal options I can leave as no. I'm going to add back the total price calculation. And in field settings, I'm going to choose not to show my username column. And then also reorder my username just to be as up here right next to the product ID. And I might do the same for the list price and quantity, so that way they're right by the total price. So I'll build the application. And before I run it, I'm going to go to the... And before I run the application, I'll go to the properties, and in the SQL statement, just like I had done with the grid update maintainer, I'm going to secure this application by the username. If I just run this, sure enough, there's my cart contents. Since this report will just get sent as a PDF to the user, I can come into the properties and do some things like remove the chart. I don't want the graph to appear in the application or the PDF. Same thing for the header and footer. I don't need to show this in the application at all, so I'll turn that to yes. Next, I'm going to go into MPainter and just clean up some of these values that are erroneously adding up that I don't need to see. So those being the class that shouldn't be totaled, nor the list price. I'll go ahead and re-add my images to this application. And just center that within the cell. These buttons up here with the make additional selections and these other options, I'll also take out of the reports. They won't be used at all in the PDF. And then in place of that, something helpful that you can add into the application, into this field button, are these common fields. So the day and time that this report runs, I can print out so the user has that on the PDF. I'm just going to center any of this text in my report. Lastly, if you remember with the class in the catalog, I use this key lookup. That way I can just show the description of each class. Add that right back in. And if I run this to PDF to see how it looks, and there we go. So while I will use this report and send it out in an email, I also am going to use this report for a completely different purpose, and that is to grab this value that the report's able to compute, this grand total of all the items in the cart, and stick it in this application and put it also in this application, both the product catalog and the final review. So there's an easy way that I can, from MPainter, set this up so that I can just pull this value out of the report. So I know that this is that value I'm interested in, so I can just click inside of that cell, go to user interface, edit element, and right before this bit of HTML, say this begin import comment, and then right afterwards I'm going to put another comment that says end import. And I can just save that. So if I go back to one of my two applications, I'll go to the final review maintainer first. I can import that value from the report right into my header. So I'm going to create some space where I want to put this imported total first. I'll do it in here where the application name is, and I just want to use the grid row options and configure row layout option to just spread this into some more equal pieces. And then inside of this last box from the toolbar, I'll click on import, select the report where I created where I put those begin import and end import tags. So I'll get a preview of the application that it's running, the report, and I can see it runs the full report, and I don't need that, so I'll just tell it to give me only the grand total because I only need that line right there. So change that like so, and these other parameters for the product and the username, I don't need those in here, so I can remove that. And under my import options, I'll tell this to just use the custom import, so look for those import comments that I put in the report. And now that value is going to be brought into my application. You'll probably want this to stand out a little bit, so you can make it larger, give it a bold or italic font to it, and just for visuals, put in another icon, like a little cart right next to that. So now when the app is always ran, the user's going to see that total of the items that they have in their cart. Now I'm going to do the exact same thing with importing the grand total into the product catalog application. So I'll just fast forward the video a bit to save some time here, since I'll be doing the exact same steps. So I've added that same import into the product catalog. However, I'm going to do something different with this grand total, is that I want this to be my link that takes the user to the review screen, that final review maintainer. So I had the link to go to the catalog from the final review. Now I'm piecing this together, so full circle, that the catalog is going to go to the review screen, and my link is going to be specifically on here. So now I can click there, get to the final review screen, and now I can easily toggle between my screens. Where my total is up here, there's some other buttons. We use the selections one to bring up the filters. These other buttons we can actually remove since they weren't used at all in the application. And I like doing that just so this looks cleaner and there's less unused options for the user to click on. All right, so now is the last piece that I'm going to put together. And this circles back to that idea of a checkout process. So in this final review maintainer, I'm going to have another button here that allows the user to actually complete their purchase. And really what this is going to do is just open up a pop-up window of another application, which I haven't created yet. And from there, that's where the checkout process will take the user's email, and that will send them an email with a link to that report. So I'm going to make a new maintainer. And this is, again, just going to be that pop-up window I'm going to use in the final review screen. And unlike any application I've built so far, it actually doesn't matter what I pick the table, and you'll notice I just picked products in the first field from there. Because this maintainer, I'm just going to be using it not to actually write to a table, but it's just going to be used to send an email once the checkout process has been completed. And we can set up that email all from this application here. So the first thing I'll do is go into the properties of this application, and I mentioned that I wanted to not write anything when the maintainer submitted, so I'll turn that skip database action to yes. And if you run the application, you'll see it only has the one field I selected, the product ID. So I'm going to go into MPainter and actually take out this row, so I can just right click inside of there and delete form row. And where that row was previously, I'm just going to put a message here. Because remember, this application is going to be used as a pop-up window to confirm whether the user wants to actually submit the order. So I'm just putting a message that goes along with that idea. And of course, once the user actually presses accept, we want to trigger off something else to happen. So I can go to this after action workflow. And this just provides an easy option that's built into the application where I can configure and set up what workflow processes or what actions do I want to kick off once somebody runs or submits my application. Setting up these processes once I'm inside the workflow designer is as simple as clicking the Add Action button and then choosing what action or task I want to happen. So I want to add an action, and this is going to send an email. So I can give it a name accordingly. And under my to, if I click on this dropdown, I have some fields that I can use, specifically the user's email address pulls from the security feature. When I turn that on, I can just pull in the user's email dynamically from here. And the rest I can just fill out my subject, the actual body of my message. I can type that all out here. And similarly with the email address, I also had the user's first name in that table when I set up security. So I can dynamically pull in the user's name to be put inside the email. And of course, I can just type out whatever I'd like to display right here. Now, specifically for my email, I'm going to highlight the receipt text and click on the link button. And this will allow me to put in the link to my report. So that way, when a user clicks on that in the email, it will generate the PDF of their purchase or just that report that was previously created. So I can save this after action to send the email, and that's all I need to do in this application. So I can return to the app specs. Now I should be able to go back to my final review maintainer and point that checkout link to the prompt maintainer that I just made. Under the target tab, go ahead and select this to be a pop-up dialog window. Now the width and height, you can usually leave these as auto and the window should resize accordingly. The target frame name, you can just change this to what the title on the pop-up window will be. And then the options for the dialog submit, once the user submits and enters the email address, I actually want this to go to another application that I have pre-built, this page redirect that looks just like this. It's a retrieval and just confirms to the user that the order was submitted. So I'm going to have this point to that application. So back in the link tab, or link info, I'll choose a button instead of just a text link. Now once I select checkout, here's this confirmation window, the application I just built, and pressing accept is going to kick off that workflow process. The email gets sent to me. And there's my page I'm redirecting to. And here is my email that I created with a link to that report that shows up as a PDF. So that's everything for the shopping cart applications. And my confirmation page just has some links that can take the user to the catalog or a home page. All in all, this didn't take too long to do. You know, these apps, it's about an hour to start with nothing and have this whole shopping cart application. If you have any questions or comments, feel free to let us know. You can comment in any of the videos or you can reach out to us directly and we'll get back to you as soon as we can. Thanks, take care.